Welcome back to the Max Reality. If you've seen my face before, then you know the drill. But if you're new here, I love talking all things reality TV. And if that sounds like something you're interested in, maybe check out my other videos and subscribe to the channel. Today, we're here to talk about a show that I happened to stumble upon a few weeks ago from none other than TLC itself, You, Me, and My Ex. As I said in the beginning, one day I was just looking around on my different streaming services of choice, trying to find something to fill my time, a different show that I could just binge, something like that. And I went to the motherland, TLC, just sure I would find a season of a show that maybe I picked up a couple years ago, you know, something like that. And I stumble upon this show called You, Me, and My Ex. It started in 2021. It's got two seasons. I don't know if we're getting a third. I've been looking into it. And honestly, all I can do is pray we get a third season because I finished both these seasons like that. I was hooked. I physically couldn't stop. It felt like a train wreck that I could just not look away from. So previously when I've done shows like this, like my courtship show, MILF Manor show, which MILF Manor did get a second season. If you've seen that video, I said they shouldn't, but I definitely will be watching it. So be on the lookout for MILF Manor 2 video when that season ends up wrapping up. Anyway, in the past where I've been going over different shows like this, they've all been game shows. So we'll do the first section where we kind of talk about the structure and all that is supposed to be spoiler free. I'm just trying to give you the setup of the show. However, this one is more of a lifestyle reality show, like 90 Day Fiancé, any of those where we're just kind of watching people. So unfortunately, there will be no real spoiler-free part of this episode, but I will say I do think it would still be worth going to watch it after watching this video because I just truly doubt that in this riffing style format that I do these videos in that I will get every single thing that was so wild about this show because truly, almost every minute was like being on a roller coaster. So that's your warning ahead of time. This is not a spoiler-free video, but I still think the show's gonna be worth it afterwards. That's all I gotta say. So all that to say, here is your disclaimer that, like I said, I'm probably gonna forget stuff. I really didn't write notes. I'm just kind of riffing. And along those same lines, some of the things I say might not be 100% right. This is just for fun. So that's your disclaimer. Go into this with all that knowledge. So how I think the best way to do the structure of this video is I'm gonna talk about the different groupings and just go over anything I can within that grouping. That way we don't have to like go back and forth because it's already, the relationships are already complicated enough. We don't need to keep up with that. And it doesn't need to be linear because some of these couples are in both seasons. Some are only in one or the other. Just think it's better to keep it comprehensive, and that'll also keep my chapters neat, which I also love. So, and the order of the groups, I can't say couples because they're not couples and they're not thruples, it's just groupings of people. It's not really going to be in any particular order. I am going to try to keep people who were in season 2 only toward the end, try to work that way a little bit so I don't miss anybody, but there's no order about this. I'm just, again, these videos are very much more of a riffing style versus my Shark Tank ones that are very scripted out. This is more, you know, for the funds. For our first group, we are gonna talk about the relationship that centers around Jimmy and Lisa. Jimmy and Lisa met in a bar in 1987. They hit it off, fell in love, got married, had a baby, but then things started not to work out and they ended up getting a divorce. And while they're in the process of getting this divorce, Jimmy meets Wendy and they start dating and eventually they get married and also have a son. So today they have a son that's 14 years old and Jimmy and Lisa's son is 20. Lisa is not alone, however, though. She has met a wonderful man named Jack, and they are engaged. And that is our first grouping. And not only are Jimmy and Lisa intertwined because of their son and their just general past relationship, they are also business partners to this day. They have an olive oil business and then some other sort of business, I'm pretty sure. They talk about the olive oil one a lot though. And as I feel like you can imagine, in the beginning there was a lot of friction between Wendy and Lisa. They really didn't get along, but slowly and surely they have started to build a relationship together, and that's how all the four of them can hang out and get along and be the little group that they are. We only get this group for season one, and their main storyline the whole season is that they are going down to visit Lisa and Jimmy's son, Dominic, to celebrate his 21st birthday. The big catch is, it's the beginning of the pandemic, so they can't just fly down to go visit him. They need a safe way to do it, and they decide the best idea is to rent an RV all together and drive 19 hours to Florida to surprise him. And underlying all of that, Lisa really thinks it's time for her and Jimmy to really explain to their son why they got divorced. Apparently, he was shielded from a lot of that because he was younger, and he doesn't necessarily even understand how they got divorced because he's only seen them be such good friends as adults, and Lisa feels like it's time to explain. And for those of you wondering at home, you probably already guessed it, but yes, there was infidelity. Jimmy cheated on her, and that was a piece of what ended up dissolving their relationship. And then below all of that, our C-plot, if you will, is Lisa has been holding on to this letter that Jimmy wrote her. I don't know the exact timeline. I'm not even 100% sure if he was with Wendy yet or not. But the point is, he wrote her a letter saying he would always be in love with her. She would always be the one, the only one for him. All of this sort of stuff. And she's kind of been harboring that feelings and emotions around that letter for a long time, and that is bubbling below the surface of all of these other things. So as you can imagine, the RV ride has its different challenges. There's moments where Wendy feels like Lisa and Jimmy are flirting too much. Lisa and Jimmy get into this huge altercation. A lot of it is very much chaos at its finest. But eventually they do get down there to see Dominic and throw him a beautiful 21st birthday party. And all is beautiful and fine until it's time for Lisa and Jimmy to talk to Dominic about their history of why they broke up and everything. And this causes friction once again between Jimmy, where he like gets up and walks away at some point. But eventually they do tell him some version of what happened. They give him more explanation than he had in the beginning. And growth happens. Growth is real. We get the full story of what happened in an interview moment. And while she's telling it in that interview moment, it's apparently Jack's first time ever hearing like their full story, which is wild to me to think about. That's the first time you're hearing that. It just shows, you know, how much that was probably built up and how truly she just like does not talk about it a lot, which I know that's just, oof. Hate that for her. Glad that this show is hopefully able to maybe heal some old wounds. And this whole season, Lisa's really been harping on the secret she has. And you're thinking, or at least I was thinking, oh, it's this letter from Jimmy that she's been holding on to. But no, the secret is that her and Jack aren't fiancés. They're married. They went and eloped and then just didn't tell anybody. Partially because Lisa says she didn't want to hurt Jimmy's feelings, which seems so wild to me, considering, like, Jimmy's married. He has a wife who's standing right there. Such a funny concept. Don't know how Jack was okay with that for so long. Like, they've been married for a minute at this point. Like, years. Years they've been keeping this secret. But they all learn from this trip that it's better to open up and communicate to build the happy, blended family they want to be. I really liked this group. I thought they were really fun. I kind of see why we didn't get a season two. I feel like they had a really good story arc, very good beginning, middle, end that we really didn't need to see into a season two. I'm sure something would have happened that would have been great. But overall, it was very nice. I sometimes forget how good TLC can be with storytelling in this way. But truly, their arc, like, honestly, again, like I said, I picked this order randomly. But they were a good one to start with. Very just clean. You know, there's drama, but it's like a good story. It's happy, happy ending. So if they would have been in season two, I would have liked to see more of the business relationship they all have going on. I think that would be a very interesting, fun dynamic to watch, especially because they really do genuinely seem to be friends. We got to see a little bit of it, but Not a lot, just because of what this kind of show is, and that we focused more on, them being in an RV and traveling. But I would love to see that dynamic a little bit more, even with another couple, if they want to give us a season three. Please, TLC, I'm begging. Our next group is Jerry, Jessica, and Kay LaVey. Jerry and Jessica have known each other about 22 years. They were married for 15 years and had four beautiful children together, but then unfortunately they had a very bad divorce and didn't talk for 5 years. But things changed when Jerry got really ill. Jessica moved in with him and their kids, not only to take care of the kids, but to help rehabilitate Jerry, and they have been living together under the same roof happily ever since, but not in a relationship, just platonically. Then comes in Kay LaVey. Jerry met her out in an airport pre-pandemic. They started to hit it off, but then, as I said, this was filming at the height of the pandemic, so their relationship pretty much had to go completely online. And Jerry decides the best way for them to really figure out if this relationship is gonna work is for her to just move in with all of them, because that's what you do at the beginning of a relationship. And on top of all that, Kay is around 25 years old, which is close in age to the oldest son of Jessica and Jerry. So we're just doing great. Everything about this, just A plus. This is another group that we only get through season one, and as you can imagine, their main storyline is Kay trying to work herself into this family so they can all become one happy unit. And as I'm sure you can imagine, this does not go well from the get-go. Kay and Jessica just have a lot of friction. I will say Jessica is older than Kay, but her and Jerry do have about a 10-year-ish age gap. So not as big as Kay and Jerry, but I will say that I just feel like that's an important fact. And overall, from the beginning, it's just not great for them. But to be fair, Kay doesn't get a very good start to go, because it turns out when she gets to the house, she's not going to be staying in Jerry's room because Jerry's youngest daughter sleeps in there a lot because she has nightmares. So he has set up a closet for Kay to sleep in on an air mattress in a closet. Yes, it's a walk-in closet, but it's like the mattress is pretty much the whole room. And it's not like he even took the clothes out. The clothes are still in there. He's added like some decoration, like a flower vase. I assume he added it. I really hope it wasn't there before. I guess I don't know that really. Oh, that's so upsetting to think that it was already like that and he just added the mattress. Anyway, and she's not down for that, as you can imagine. He ends up moving her to the family's giant game room that's like their bottom floor, which also happens to be around where their eldest son's room is. And Jerry makes a weird, like, sex joke about that, which it's like, why are you making a joke about your girlfriend possibly hooking up with your son? Like, is that already not? Anyway, she moves down there. That causes extra friction. And literally, there's not a moment, a singular moment of peace watching this group. Every single moment, there is something going wrong. Like, I swear, I really wanted them to be in season two. Unfortunately, they were not. I kind of assumed they wouldn't be, considering the blowout that Kay has with them at the end. Highly recommend going to watch it. The exit interview, gold. TV gold. I just was sitting there like so uncomfortable, but so funny to watch. Just a mess. But you never know. Jerry could have found a new girlfriend in that time. From what I could tell from their social media, it seems like Jessica has moved out. She's living back on her own. Her and Jerry aren't living together. Obviously, as I kind of have alluded to, Kay LaVey and Jerry did not continue their relationship. They broke up, and that group is completely dissolved. So that one will give zero. No, I'm just kidding. It seems like Jessica and Jerry probably still have a fine, like, family relationship. They're just not, she's not caring for him anymore with his illness and everything. She has moved on with her own life, which, good for her. Another key detail that I failed to mention is at the very beginning, he asks Kay LaVey to quarantine, which that makes sense, 100%. Quarantine before she moves into the house. He asks her to quarantine at the family's cabin that they have. So, my question to him and to everyone here is why not him and Kay LeVay move into that cabin? It seems like it couldn't have been that far because he sends his sons. He doesn't even go to get her because he needs to set up for her. I guess set up the closet. Anyway, he sends his sons to go pick her up driving. So it honestly can't be that far if you're sending your sons to go get her. Why not y'all two move in there for like a month, test out the relationship? I get his idea of like wanting to see her in person. That definitely is whatever, fine. But if you had a whole other house you could be using, why are you subjecting your whole family to this woman that they don't know, that they didn't ask to know, and also subjecting her to this environment where honestly, like it just doesn't go well from the beginning, and I wholeheartedly 100% blame Jerry for all of it, because it honestly also seems like from everything that happened that he kind of just sprung this on everyone. Didn't really ask, just kind of did it. And it's like, really? Really? It just, such a train wreck. Highly recommend watching all of their stuff because wowee. Our next group that we're going to talk about originates from the couple of Jennifer and Josh. You should be able to see now why it's been so hard for me to categorize all of this because it's like, who do I t like? How do I connect? Because some of these people have other partners, some don't. Anyway, Jennifer and Josh and their new partners. Jennifer and Josh were together. They had a kid. They did the whole marriage thing. But ultimately, according to Jennifer, they were never really on the same page of where they wanted to be in life. She was very much party, party, go out, that sort of thing. And Josh very much wanted to settle down and have a family. And ultimately, that led to a lot of unhappiness in their relationship. Then Jennifer, who had been straight her whole life, ends up meeting Chantel at work and starts to develop a sort of bond with her. And ultimately, because of that and the other issues they were having, her and Josh get a divorce, and she continues things on with her new partner, Chantel. Fear not, though, Josh also moved on and found new love with Danielle. They also had a kid and were married and are now happily living together. And all four of them are very friendly. They have a good relationship. And we find out that our main storyline for this season is the fact that Jennifer and Chantel are trying to get pregnant, and their sperm donor is no other than Josh. The intro for their group is so great because Josh is very much like the awkward, kind of shy, nerdy, funny guy. I love watching Josh. And he has Danielle and Jennifer and Chantel there on the couch. They're all together. And he's like, got baby mama number one, baby mama number two, and hopefully baby mama number three. And this is before you know anything about them. So you're just sitting there like, so is this you, me, and my ex, and my ex? Or it's so funny the way he says it too. Like, it's obvious that their group has a very good dynamic. It's very funny, cute, love watching them. So as you can imagine, we see a bunch of the ups and downs of Jennifer and Chantel trying to get pregnant and just the ins and outs of all of their relationships and friendships in general. And ultimately, they do end up getting pregnant, and we even get to see them give birth to their sweet baby girl, Camilla. But they do spend some time in the NICU, which is very scary. But ultimately, they end as a happy family with this new addition to their beautiful blended family that they're creating. Then we move on into season two, and where we left off with them in season one was there was a little bit of conflict between their extended family, like the moms and dads of all of them and whatnot, about what Josh's role was going to be in Camilla's life. And they're obviously like, he's not the dad, he's just the donor. That's all it is. And there's conflict about the grandparents and whatnot, being like, well, he's gonna want to be the dad. And that is our kind of main conflict we leave on. And it's kind of brought up again in the beginning of season two, but our actual group is very secure in what their titles and roles are. So this is just kind of like auxiliary noise we're getting. Our main point for season two is that the four of them have decided that they're gonna move in together. To be fair, technically, three of them have decided that, And one has agreed, but is not happy about it. That is Chantel. She is like, this is not going to work. We're going to do it, but mark my words, this will not work. And they decide, which I think is a very smart plan. I was very worried at the beginning, but they do come up with a good plan, is they're going to rent out where they currently live to other people and rent a place altogether just to try it out. That way, if they hate it, they can go back to their current living situations. No harm, no foul. So that is a good thing. So many of these shows, you'll see people be like, I don't know. At least these people are thinking. And I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to pretend with y'all. I 100% was like, yeah, this will be great. What will go wrong? This is a good idea. They're all so close. They already take care of each other's kids. This will just make a better community and things will be great. I was like, Chantel is just being negative. Yeah, I was 100% wrong. It is very difficult with all of them living together. They just, you know, they have different schedules. They appreciate, you know, the community they have, but ultimately they decide that it's best for the whole relationship between all of them as a group if they continue to live separately. And after all of the turmoil, by the end of the season, they're back living separately. On top of that, toward the end of the season and mid-end of the season, we find out that Danielle and Josh are also wanting to have another baby, and that Danielle had a lot of health complications with her first kid, and it's not really advised that she tries to have another. And they end up kind of proposing to Chantel if she'll carry their baby, because Chantel's the one who carried for her and Jennifer, so they're just asking her to be pregnant again with Josh's kid, like, same sort of thing. And again, we don't have a season 3, so I really don't have a solid update for y'all. And that's why they should give us a season 3. From what I can glean off social media, it doesn't seem like Josh and Danielle have had that second kid yet. But I will say it seems like the family unit and structure is still intact, because there's photos of all three kids together. And, you know, Josh and Danielle's kid probably wouldn't be a part of those photos if there was friction, because there's really no reason for her to need to be there. But there's photos with all the three kids together, all of them like sort of being together. So that's what's really important, because I personally loved watching their dynamic. I thought it was a really fun, interesting dynamic to watch. They're one of the people that I would die for a season 3 for, because I'd love to see how their relationship continues to grow. Now that they're back in their separate houses, they have their kids, just what does day-to-day life look like for them as their sort of uniquely blended family? It's also cute because Josh and Chantel work together, not work, volunteer together, not hosting. I'm not a sports person. Coaching. They coach Jace's hockey team together, who is Jennifer and Josh's son. So all of their relationships between all the adults and the kids, I liked seeing that on TV. It seemed very healthy. They had their fights, but they seemed to work it out. It was honestly good TV. Another reason to go check it out. I seriously saw the commercial. I liked the show. I want y'all to watch it and for them to give us a season 3. Everybody just go stream it at the same time. They'll see the spike. They'll do it. There could already be a season 3 that I just don't know about, so this could all be ranting for nothing. Sorry if it is. Our next group is Alex, Caroline, and Steven. It all started when, back in the day, Alex and Steven were dating. They dated for a while, they were really close, but ultimately there were infidelity issues and it didn't end up working out, and they broke up, but remained the very best of friends. Then Alex and Caroline met at work. Caroline had no idea that Alex had any interest in women, and he was just one of her very best friends until one night he ended up kissing her in a kitchen. That's her story of how they ended up beginning to date, and the rest is history. They've been dating for a while, they're very close, they see themselves getting married, and they just have the third wheel of Steven hanging along. Our biggest storyline for them is the fact that they're meeting each other's families and also just Steven in general. Like, an interesting thing about him is the fact that, again, since this is in the height of the pandemic, his family was super, super COVID conscious, good for them, and they would like not let him leave the house whatsoever. He was still living at home, and so he's just calling Alex, FaceTiming him 24/7 to the point he even FaceTimes them during their Valentine's Day dinner. And Alex answers it. Criminal. Criminal. I can't. As you can imagine, another big hurdle for them is that everybody in their lives is allergic to the word bisexual, or literally any other word that's not gay or straight. I don't know exactly how Alex identifies himself. I'm not trying to identify him. He really doesn't, technically, during this show, but he's obviously not gay or straight. And he makes that pretty clear, and nobody else can seem to comprehend that. They're like, well, you were with a guy. You were with a guy for a really long time, so there's just seriously no logical way you could ever like women. There's only one or the other. There's one or the other. And that's a very, very big point throughout the whole season and into season two, because this is another couple we get for season one and season two. And honestly, the majority of season one, as I said, is them just meeting different people and people judging them. That's what it felt like for the majority of season one. They start off with like a mixed group of, I think, mostly Caroline's like auxiliary family, for lack of a better word, like cousins, stuff like that, sister maybe even. And then also Alex's sister is there, and there's just friction because Alex's sister is very much a big Steven fan, feels like Alex should get back with Steven. Lots of friction. Again, then we have Caroline going to meet Alex's family, like his dad, his other sister, stuff like that. That goes very badly with Alex yelling and ending up leaving. He's like, Caroline, are you coming with me? And then he just bounces, and Caroline ends up having to like call an Uber to get back to him. And then they meet Caroline's mom, who she's kind of estranged from because obvious reasons if you watch the show. She's just very I'm trying to think of like the nice ways. I don't know how to say it. She's very upper class. She has certain envisionings. She has certain ideas for her family. And I don't think Alex fits into them with his flamboyant, fun, awesome, energetic person that he is, if that makes sense. Through all those trials, though, they are able to stick together, and Alex decides that if they're able to get through all that, they can get through anything, and he wants to propose to Caroline. He does. She says yes, and they kind of end the season with a big engagement party saying that they're going to get married, and their families come together. I think it's very cute. There's still people that are skeptical, but that's okay because we get them in season two, so we get to see where it leads. We start season two with Alex and Caroline finding out there won't be a wedding after all because they already eloped. And on top of that, they're expecting a baby. We also get more of Steven in real life this season, as he's now allowed to leave the house. So they break this news to him being like, yo, we're not having a bachelor party, we're having a dachelor party. And Caroline being pregnant, this party, them having the baby, is our big story arc for season two for them. So we start with just the having a baby aspect. Caroline is not very well versed in the world of babies whatsoever. Alex has a little experience with siblings and nieces and nephews, but you know, they don't have a lot. They have cats. Cats are their thing, which I feel them because dogs are mine. So I get it, animals. But at one point, Alex's sister leaves their babies with them to watch for the day, which is hilarious. We also have the whole dachelor party, which Caroline, who again is pregnant. This poor woman is pregnant, and I've never been pregnant, but I know that that makes your brain just melt, and it's hard. I understand it. It's hard. She says the only thing she doesn't want is strippers, and so Alex lets Steven, his ex, his best friend, somebody who causes a little bit of tension, because Caroline's like, wish this wasn't all the time. Honestly, I told y'all, this was me riffing. I'm gonna go on random tangents. I'm so sorry. Caroline handles him a lot better than I would, because that man calls all the time. I would be losing it. But still, all she asks is no strippers, and Steven can't even respect that and gets a stripper, which Alex, to be fair, is very upset with and leaves right away, but doesn't tell Caroline, which, again, I get, because she's pregnant, she's hormonal, it's a lot, but also I don't get. You should tell her right away. That is the best. I have learned that in my adult years. I did not understand it as a child, but adult to adult, it is always better Just a tell. It's always worse when someone catches you in a lie, and you're most of the time not going to get away with it. So don't. Especially when you're being filmed for reality TV. You're not going to get away with it in any world. A producer is going to tell them, or it's going on TV. One of the two. Caroline and Alex end up having their beautiful baby. He does end up having some health issues, which is very hard on Caroline. Very understandable. We get this sweet moment with Caroline and Alex. I was literally sobbing. I had to pause the show because, Caroline is having all this mom guilt of like, what could I done to make him not end up having these different health issues? And Alex is trying to comfort her, saying like, you did everything you could. Like, we heard the doctors. There's nothing we could have done. We just got to take care of him. And if we do, he's going to be okay. And we're going to do that. And watching them in that moment, just I already knew, I could see that they had a great relationship, but seeing that moment in particular just made me, I wish they could just show that to every single person who's weird about their relationship and who they were with before, because that's just living proof of what good partners they are. I just, oh, it was just, oh, it was such a good, especially for reality TV, it was such a good moment to see. Again, I was on the floor sobbing, had to take a break. It was just top tier TV and top tier life moment. I hope a lot of people saw that and felt comfort in their own struggles and journeys with babies, infants, and all that. I can't say enough. Top tier. But they are still having a lot of different issues with their family, and the season kind of culminates for them in them having a sip and see for their baby that's friends only, no family, because the family has just caused too much drama. But it doesn't matter if the family's not there, because drama just takes off anyway. To start with, we have another you, me, and my ex sort of spin-off situation happening almost, because I feel like I'm gonna need graphs for this. I'm sorry to myself in advance for trying to edit this and make this clear for y'all. So we have Alex and Steven. When they were dating, they were friends with this other gay guy couple whose names I'm so sorry, but I cannot remember right now and I'm not gonna look them up. Anyway, Alex is still friends with this guy, right? And Steven is now dating this guy. So they're together. Another you, me, and my ex situation. Sort of almost, but they haven't really told Alex or really anyone yet. But they're all there together at the sip and see. So obviously, it comes out. It causes minor drama, honestly, not too much. The main drama is there's someone there that Caroline has beef with on Alex's behalf because he owes Alex money and all of this other stuff. And Caroline ends up throwing water or some sort of drink on this man. And the whole party just ends up exploding into Bravo level chaos. And pretty much that is the end of what we get on TV for this couple. Again, another reason to give us season three. And while there's not a season three, you know me, I looked for some sort of updates. And as far as I can tell, Alex and Caroline are still together because they posted recently that they're expecting their second child. If we get a season three, I really hope we get them, and I hope we get to see them continue their journey of being parents. I really like their story, and I hope if they are in season three, we can move away from the whole story of like, what's Alex's sexuality? Because it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's so silly to keep playing on at this point. I mean, it's 2024 anyway. It's such a weird thing to put this weird dichotomy on it. I just want to see their relationship because, as I said earlier, like just seeing from that moment where their son was really sick and them talking, and even some of their other friends brought this up. Like, when you really see them together, it makes sense why they're together, and their relationship just, it seems so sweet and fun. And I would love to see more of it in a season three, but as far as I can tell, like I said, they're still together, they're expecting their second kid, and good for them. I did say the couples were in no particular order, but I definitely saved this couple for the end of the season one group because they're the most cu- I said couple again. Take a shot every time I say couple instead of group. I saved this group for last because it's definitely the most convoluted of the groups, and I felt like the hardest to explain. So let's get into it. So we'll start with what I consider the origin, which is April and Roy. So April had a first husband, unnamed. They had two kids. They got divorced. She ended up meeting Roy because she was dating one of Roy's friends. Her and Roy ended up falling in love, getting engaged, getting married, and having a son. But ultimately, things didn't work out. And this is where I'll introduce John and Lauren, who are April and Roy's neighbors, who are also having difficulties in their relationship. From this, April and John start to form their own connection, bonding over the fact that their marriages aren't working. And honestly, the timeline is kind of murky for me. Maybe if I rewatched it and took very diligent notes, I would have it. But anyway, from Roy's perspective, from what I can remember, he pretty much got a phone call from April being like, "Hey, this isn't gonna work. We're ending it." He was deployed because he's in the military. He comes home and John is in his house, and the rest is history. April and John are now together, and then there's Lauren and Roy. As I can assume, you would imagine, April and Lauren very much did not get along at first. They were very much in opposition, did not like each other, fighting all the time. But one day, things changed, and they became the best of friends to the point that they have a podcast together about how they do their blended family, and they are literally just like tied at the hip. Best friends make John uncomfortable level of best friends, which honestly, I love it. This is another season one and two couple. Their main storyline drama for season one is the fact that April and John are gonna renew their vows. They already got married, but they didn't have the whole big wedding because there was a lot of drama with the way things unfolded, as one can imagine from what I've already said. So they want to have the wedding of their dreams, and there is the drama of number one, getting engaged. Then also, April asks Lauren to be her maid of honor, and she throws a bachelorette party for the woman who's marrying her ex-husband. So that's lots of fun. And then also, April has to talk to Roy about it, who's still very sensitive about everything that's happened. Very valid, understandable for him. So that is their big storyline, is getting this wedding to happen. Ultimately, it does happen. There's some wishy-wash if Roy will end up coming. He comes for a little bit, congratulates April, and overall, it ends with everybody relatively happy. Then we go into season two, where from the beginning, it's obvious there's an issue because nobody is sitting in the seats they were sitting beforehand on the couch, and there is also some footage they are showing of the producers being like, where are you gonna sit, blah, 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 and them arguing over it. We also see footage of April and John arguing about their dog. There's obviously unrest among this group. So it turns out things have not been rainbows and sunshines for April and John. They have not had the best of luck in their relationship, and they are currently separated. On top of that, Lauren has moved into the house. So April, at this point, has out now had Roy in this house as her partner, John in this house as her partner, and now Lauren in this house, who she is calling pretty much her domestic partner. They say that they don't have like a sexual relationship, but they have a platonic relationship, raising their kids, doing all that, and they want to live together and do that. And that is our main storyline of season two, is April and John separating, where Roy is in all of this, and Lauren and April's relationship as best friends and domestic partners trying to live together and raise their kids. Ultimately, during the season, we see April and Lauren go to visit Roy, where he's living. April has thoughts of wanting her and Lauren to move out there where Roy is, but Lauren has to break it to April that she's actually started like a real romantic relationship with a woman. So she doesn't know if, their whole domestic partnership is going to work out. And especially on top of that, no matter what, she can't move right now because she is trying to develop that relationship. So this leaves April in a kind of like limbo, as best as I can say. And it's just a lot of upheaval and turmoil altogether. Another good reason to give us a season 3. So unfortunately, none of these people are like super online. Really, the only person I could get a lot of information from was April's Instagram. And from what I can tell, it's very obvious that her and John have split up. You can see when they were together and when they're not. But it doesn't really seem like recently she's posted a lot of Lauren or Roy, so I don't know where her relationships with the two of them are. It doesn't seem like her and Lauren are doing that podcast anymore, so very hard to say where those relationships are now. Hopefully they're still like in a good, like cordial, familial place, but I really don't know. They're not very much online, so if you know anything, definitely leave it in the comments. But from what I could tell, it's very unclear. We would need a season 3 to find out. A season 3 TLC. I'm a rapper. Our next group is DeAndre, Elodie, and Rowan. We start with DeAndre and Rowan. They met while Rowan was in college, and DeAndre was playing minor league baseball. He was visiting where his family lived when he met Rowan at a bar. They started dating. They hit it off. They moved together to Atlanta, where they continued dating, but ultimately decided that it wasn't working out, and they ended up breaking up. DeAndre moved to Miami, and then he met Elodie. One thing I will say is I saw one article saying that Rowan and DeAndre met while Rowan was on Love Island. So number one, I'm going to use that as a segue to say DeAndre was on season 2 of Love Island USA. But as far as I can tell, Rowan was not. So I'm pretty sure that that bar story is how they met, because she doesn't have any pictures from being on Love Island, anything like that. I just saw one article say that they met on Love Island. I don't think that's right. So if you see that, I don't know what to tell you. Anyway, in Atlanta, Rowan started to get close to DeAndre's mom, who had also moved there, and she asked for dating advice even while she was with DeAndre, and they formed a really tight bond that did not break despite her and DeAndre breaking up. And as I said earlier, DeAndre has moved to Miami, where he has started a new relationship with Elodie. And our main issue and storyline throughout season 2 is, number one, DeAndre's mom wants him to get back together with Rowan. Also, subplot to all of that is they have a bunny together. I want to also point out, I'm not saying Rowan at any point wants to get back together with him. She is just in this, and they happen to have a bunny together. That's that subplot. On top of this, Rowan has been given this sort of like company gift to do a vacation spa retreat sort of thing, and she invites DeAndre to go with her. So there's this whole tension of like, should they be allowed to go on a trip together by themselves as exes, and the new girl, Elodie, wanting to be involved with that. We get lots of uncomfort as they have a whole big event that is supposed to be supporting and celebrating stuff DeAndre's doing, and Rowan, DeAndre's mom, and Elodie are all gonna be there, and they're all supposed to meet. Ultimately, DeAndre spends a lot of time talking about Rowan and DeAndre's mom and kind of making Elodie feel like she's a second-class citizen, not really introducing her, and she feels a little left out, which creates some tension. But this also creates the perfect moment for Elodie to talk to Rowan about the trip, and she gets herself invited, and they all go on this trip. DeAndre has his own room in it anyway, obviously, thankfully. So Elodie is with him in there, and then Rowan has her own room. And they all go on this trip together as a weird threesome. I completely glided over the fact that DeAndre's mom cannot get Elodie's name right. And they keep trying to tell her what it is. And she's trying her best. You can tell, but she is not getting it. She's like, Ellery, Ellily, anything else except Elodie. It's so funny. I think Ellery is what she ended up landing on, and they stopped correcting her at that point because they had all tried to get it right with her. But it was such a good little side note to throw in there. It was so bad. It's like Elodie going up to her, baring her soul about how much she loves her son and she just wants her to accept her. And then his mom is like, I understand, Ellery. It's so bad. It's so funny, though. So no part of this trip really goes 100%, but Elodie then decides to invite DeAndre to her Father's Day plan. I just made the realization that I completely glossed over the fact that Elodie has a child, so I guess I'll talk about that really quick. I told y'all, this is me riffing, so... Sorry, it's not that it's not important, but the whole Rowan stuff very much was like the very first part to getting into this. Elodie does have a previous relationship. She is a child. She is just platonic with that person. He's not very much in the picture. He's not really like an extension of you, me, and my ex. I mean, he is brought up because he is the father of their child, but not in any sort of way some of these other exes are brought up. Therefore, that's kind of why I didn't think to mention him, but here we are now. Elodie wants to invite DeAndre to their whole, like, Father's Day thing they're doing, and this causes lots more tension. DeAndre's late, her family already doesn't have great opinions of him, and everything continues to just completely dissolve to the point where we find out they end up breaking up. And we end the season with DeAndre, Rowan, and DeAndre's mom having dinner, talking, and his mom being like, I want y'all together. And that's where we leave off with that whole group in season 2. So while we may not have an update from season 3, from what I can see from their respective Instagrams, it seems like they've all moved on into new and different relationships. So good for them. If we did have a season 3, we probably wouldn't see from them, as it seems like they have all kind of scattered and moved on. I mean, you never know. Rowan still might be friends with DeAndre, but they are in new relationships, so we might not get a lot for season 3 if we got anything from them, but good for them moving on. And last but not least, we have another season 2 only couple, Matt, Kenzie, and Chelsea. We start with Matt and Chelsea, who dated very much on and off for about 3 years, and during one of their off times is when Matt met Kenzie, started dating her, and fell in love and said goodbye to Chelsea. However, Matt and Chelsea did stay very good friends, and our whole plotline for season 2 is the fact that Chelsea needs some place to stay, and she ends up staying with Matt and Kenzie. But that isn't all, because we have the fun little B-plot of the fact that Matt is planning to propose to Kenzie and has enlisted Chelsea to help him in this endeavor. I'm just gonna dive into my opinions on them. To start out, their whole dynamic is so weird. It is very obvious, at least to me, from the start, that Chelsea obviously still wants to be with Matt, no matter what issues may have caused them to break up that she saw. It is very clear that she still wants to be with him, and Matt being so oblivious actually kills me. I will give him the fact that she does not say it, and people do, like, you can't fault him. I will never fault somebody if the other person didn't say it. At least from what we see and what they both say, it doesn't seem like she ever explicitly said that, but it's just so hard watching it as a viewer. Our first biggest clue into this is pretty much one of the first interactions we see between all of them, which is Kenzie needs Matt to do something around the house, but Chelsea needs his help because she needs to get her car fixed. She needs somebody to give her a ride from, like, the place she's getting her car fixed. And Matt is like, no worries, I'll make this work with both of you. I'll give her a ride really quick. And then me and her will both help you, Kinsey, with whatever you need around the house, considering Chelsea's staying here. So, that seems reasonable. Seems like a good compromise. Everybody's gonna get what they want. No, obviously not. Because Matt and Chelsea end up going on this little joyride and go to the bar and get drunk and hang out all day and leave Kenzie to just doing these random chores and just cause a great mess where there's still issues where they're gonna need help getting Chelsea's car and just overall making a bigger mess instead of helping with anything. So, honestly, huge red flags from the beginning. If I was Kinsey, anyway. But the relationship continues, and Matt ends up opening up to Chelsea, saying he wants to propose to Kinsey and wants her help with it, starting off with them trying to go pick out a ring for Kinsey. And from the get-go, she is a Debbie Downer, saying things like, he's not ready to get married, and this, that, and the other, but she still goes with him ring shopping, but doesn't end up being super helpful. Pretty much in the end, we find out she's very insecure about the fact that she's gonna lose her best friend. She feels like once he's married and with Kinsey completely, he won't have as much time for her, Chelsea, and that is a problem. Ultimately, the day comes where Matt is ready to propose to Kinsey. He has this entire plan of proposing to her in this pumpkin patch in front of her entire family. He has Chelsea and his other best friend involved, and on the day of proposal, Chelsea is nowhere to be found. She has moved out of him and Kinsey's house without saying anything, and he is calling Chelsea, and she is not answering, making this whole day where he's supposed to be focused on proposing to the love of his life about worrying about where the heck his friend is. But to my surprise, Matt decides he's not gonna let this faze him. The whole plan originally was that Matt was supposed to be setting up their friend with Chelsea on a blind date. They were all gonna go to the pumpkin patch. That was the cover. So that way, him and Kinsey could separate from Chelsea and the other guy without it being weird. And he's like, we're just gonna have to figure it out. We're gonna separate from him and we're not gonna make it weird. So they do this whole oh, so you don't mind being a third wheel? And the guy's like, no. And Matt, Kinsey, and the guy friend all go to the pumpkin patch. They hang out, they do fun stuff. In the meantime, Matt is still trying to find Chelsea because it'd be more convenient if she showed up and was helpful, but again, he cannot find her. So they carry on. They end up losing his friend in the corn maze. They come out eventually at the end to Kinsey seeing her whole family, and Matt ends up proposing. And what do you know? Chelsea shows up at the very end, hides out in the back, and watches. And ultimately, Matt and Kinsey get engaged, and Chelsea is there watching in the background, and Matt has some words to say to her, obviously. While we end in happily ever after for Matt and Kinsey in their proposal and acceptance of that, we still have the whole issue with Matt and Chelsea. He still wants to meet up with her and see what's wrong, and ultimately, he finds out what I feel like anybody could find out just from watching their relationship for 2 seconds, which is the fact that Chelsea is still super attached to him, and it hurt her a whole lot that he had this new relationship. And while that's not his fault because she didn't say anything, it's just one of those classic relationships where you see it and you can't interfere. It's just the way it is. And at the end of the day, I don't know what's happening with them because we don't have a season three. How many times can I say that? Also, this one really could benefit from season three because all three of these people have very private social media, so I really don't have an update for you. I don't know what's going on with them. So if you do, once again, let me know in the comments. I didn't see anything right away, so I'm not sure. Did Kinsey and Matt get married? Are Chelsea and Matt still friends? What happened? Who knows? Not me. And those are all the couples from season 1 and 2 of TLC's You, Me, and My Ex. If you have enjoyed this video, please don't forget to give it a like down below. It means a lot. And if you like this sort of content in general, maybe subscribe to the channel. As I said, leave all your thoughts, opinions, comments, feelings, everything down below. And until then, I'll see y'all in the next one.